Every moment in time creates questions the human mind cannot answer. Out of reach, past all we can see, hear, and touch, beyond all we understand, lies... the extraordinary. The extraordinary is the long history of ghostly sightings in this brutal colonial jail.
Sounds like sobbing, and it was really hard sobbing, and someone really crying for some reason. I don't know why. Well, I was the only person in the building, and I couldn't understand why I could hear this noise, and it sounded as though it was either a child or a woman.
It is said the lonely spirits of the executed still walk the lonely corridors. It is the astronauts who have reported seeing strange things in space. Things even they cannot explain.
When we went to the moon, conventional wisdom was Earth was the biological center of the universe. This was the only place in the universe that had intelligent life like ourselves. There is enough evidence to suggest that there is more known in this area than is available to the public. And many people believe that our governments are engaged in a large cover-up in this regard. I think it's quite possible.
The extraordinary is the people who believe in cryonics, snap freezing of the body to be reinstated to life sometime in the future.
The prospect of living for a long time and seeing what the future is going to bring is very exciting. People who are first being exposed ask, well, why do you want to live for such a long time? And the only way to answer that question really is to turn it around and say, well, why do you want to die?
It is the parachutist who jumped out of a plane and slammed into the fuselage so hard his body left an imprint.
I started thinking of some really weird things now, you know, like I couldn't do anything. I was really mad because I had this feeling like, here I am, perfectly okay. You know, I was talking to myself and I tried everything I could, and I could look down, I could see the ground, and I kept thinking, I'm okay now, but when I hit that, I'm gonna die.
Then he plummeted thousands of meters to Earth with no parachute and lived. Just some of the stories that lie beyond our normal understanding. Tonight, on The Extraordinary.
More on the ultimate survival a little later. Good evening. I'm Warwick Moss. Bushranger Ned Kelly was just one of many criminals put to death in the infamous Melbourne Jail. A notorious place of death and suffering, the jail was home to gruesome acts of punishment and retribution. Most of the sad souls who faced the executioner left the prison, but some may have stayed on to walk its corridors forever. Old Melbourne Jail has a harsh and brutal history. From the day it opened in 1845 to the day it closed in 1929, more than 50,000 prisoners languished behind its cold and forbidding walls. Today, it's a museum packed with macabre exhibits, reminders of the 100 men and 4 women who were sent to the scaffold here and died by the hangman's noose. A cruel but swift dispatch, according to the museum manager, Amanda Baker.
The hangman would have visited the prisoner in the cell, and that's to measure the strength of their neck and to weigh them to make sure that the length of the rope was the right length so that they were hanged correctly. If the rope was too long, then the head would come away from the body when the hanging was done. And if the rope was too short, then the person would be strangled rather than hanged. And hanging was breaking the neck. It was like that.
Among those who met their end in Melbourne Jail was Australia's most famous, or infamous, bushranger, Ned Kelly.
he walked these dark, dank corridors for the last time on November the 11th, 1880. That is the gruesome. But now, more than a century later, there are the ghostly attractions, which beckoned from the cells of old Melbourne Jail. Unexplained happenings by day and by night. Amanda Baker wasn't one to believe in ghost stories. At least, not until she took over as manager of the museum 7 years ago. Now, she's not so sure.
When I first started here at the jail, the manager at the time, he told me about a lady who used to come in, and every time she came in, she'd stand at one end of the cell block and look towards the other end, and she'd see these three figures of what she thought were women. And it just happened every single time. I never met this woman. All I did was hear this story from my previous manager.
And staff too have had weird experiences. Experiences that stretch the imagination and defy logic.
We have a tour guide here called Bob. He's been with us for about 5 years, and he was starting his tour up on the stairs back there. And somebody asked him straight off the top, said, "Oh, are there any ghosts here?" And he said, "Oh no, is there nothing that we've experienced?" And at that time, there's a cell just sort of directly to the side of him while he was doing his tour, and the light flashed off, on, off, on. And that was just the one light. Now, we found that there was nothing wrong with the globe, and for that to happen, for it to be a circuit failure or anything like that, had to happen to all these cells on this side, as they're all on the same electricity circuit.
But it was a personal encounter that caused Amanda Baker to really question what was going on inside this place, where so many suffered and so many died.
I left the cell that night, I got my coat and everything was in order, and I closed the door and I went out and locked the door behind me and went home. Then I came in the next morning and I was the first one in, and I went in to hang up my coat and I look on the ground and there's the sugar canister smashed in the middle of the floor. There's also, we had a basket hanging up on the wall, and that was also on the floor. There was no reason for that. There was no wind or no nothing could ever get into that cell from when I closed it the night before. There's no explanation as we would know it. The sugar canister I found, it was on the floor and it was smashed, and the glass wasn't everywhere. It was all sort of neat in a nice little pile. But there's no explanation except for something, a being in here.
Sometimes, even in the light and safety of the museum shop, Severina Stella also ponders the ghosts of Melbourne Jail. Especially the night she was left alone to lock up. First, for no apparent reason, a light bulb shattered. Then, 10 minutes later, she began hearing strange noises.
I realised it sounded like sobbing, and it was really hard sobbing, someone really crying for some reason, I don't know why. Well, I was the only person in the building, and I couldn't understand why I could hear this noise, and it sounded as though it was either a child or a woman. And I thought, oh no, don't tell me I'm experiencing something unnatural and I'm hearing some ghost or something in here. I don't go around saying it was a ghost, but at the same time I don't go around saying it's not. I tell a lot of people strange things do happen in here, that I work here 5 days a week and I can't start believing in ghosts, otherwise I'd probably go crazy. But I'm not going to say that they don't exist, because there is something in here.
Monique Weir also believes there could be something or someone lurking in the jail. And maybe she has the evidence to prove it. Monique is a keen photographer and saw the old prison as a perfect subject. On the day in question, she was absolutely certain she was alone in this section of the cell block. she fired off a series of photographs and later sent the roll of film to be developed.
And when I got it back, I sort of didn't notice at first, and then had another closer look and thought, oh, there's something really weird here. But I just sort of shook it off. I'm a bit sort of, don't really believe in ghosts or anything like that. And it wasn't until a few other people started to have a look at it that they realised there was probably something there.
That something again. But what? Well, in one print, there seems to be a misty, floating object that wasn't visible through the camera's viewfinder. And in another, a more defined figure.
On the left-hand side was this man, well, it looked like a man, back of a man, quite tall, with a big overcoat on, it looked like. And he looked like he had really broad shoulders. And that's sort of really all I could see. He was quite sort of transparent. And you could only see the top and not the bottom.
At first, Monique was sceptical and checked the negatives in her own darkroom. The figures were on them too. So she took the photographs back to the processing lab for a second opinion.
Oh, they were quite freaked out about it. They could see that it was on the negative and it wasn't anything that was done in the printing process. They were really quite freaked out.
When the old jail finally closed 65 years ago, no doubt there was a collective sigh of relief amongst the caring souls of Melbourne. A hope that the days of torture and brutality were over, dead and buried, like so many of its former inmates. But now, there are those who wonder whether the echoes of those days don't still resound through the cells in this notorious building.
It is definitely a strange place. It's a beautiful building, but it is a very strange place. There's been a lot of suffering, a lot of pain, a lot of death in here. There's got to be something in here. There definitely is. I'm not saying Ned Kelly's floating around or anything like that, but with all the pain and suffering in here, there's got to be something.
Sometimes I'm half asleep when I hear him coming.
Is this story fiction?
He'll-